and classes. This is short topic today. So as the terminology indicates, antacid means anti-acids. So antacids, they have been used for centuries in the treatment of patients with dyspepsia and acid-peptic disorders. So they were the mainstay of treatment for acid-peptic disorders until the advent of H2-receptor blockers and proton pump inhibitors. So by the way, dyspepsia in general means patients with abdominal distension, early satiety, burning sensation or abdominal pain. Four criteria. So what is the main mechanism of action of antacids? So basically they neutralize acids. They neutralize acidity, they cause an action of pain in acid or peptic related disorders, they aid in mucus, aid their healing, and they attenuate the peptic acid activity because when there is less acid, the pepsin activity is decreased. And it increases the bicarbonate and prostaglandin secretion, and that makes us a therapeutic advantage which is rapid in onset and provides rapid relief of symptoms. So dyspepsia, when you use antacids, they get its immediate relief. So the classification, antacids are basically classified as systemic and non-systemic antacids. The systemic antacids are mainly soda or bicarbonate. This works by chemical neutralization of gastric acid. So it acts instantaneously, but it has a lot of side effects like hypernatremia as well as metabolic alkalosis. So for antacids, which act by absorption of acid, these are the commonly used ones, like in the form of calcium, magnesium and aluminium. So these are the three main things. Again, aluminium and magnesium, they are available together also in the form of megaltrate. So what are the types of antacid? As I said earlier, soda bicarb, that's a systemic one, not used nowadays. Except in some nephrology, they have some indications. So what we use frequently are calcium salts, magnesium salts, aluminium salts, and combinations. Antacids with antiflagellants like cimethicone or limethicone, as well as alginates. I'll come to that later. So first of all is soda bicarb, which is very highly soluble and it gets for instantaneous action, what is available in many soda waters. That's a quick concept but very short duration of facts. They cause metabolic alkalosis, that is very important. The sodium content may also cause problems in patients with the congestive heart failure, and if wherever there is fluid retention in edema, like renal insufficiency. So then calcium salts again, there are different forms are available, but carbonate is the most widely used one. Again, calcium, as we all know, it causes constipation. And of course, long-term use can cause kidney renal stone diseases. And the long duration of action may cause increased gastric acid secretion. It's a paradox. Hyperacidity rebound can occur. So in those days, many people used to say, whenever there is acidity, you take milk or curd rice, etc. Of course, they give some instantaneous relief, actually. But when you take it continuously, they can cause a paradoxical acidity. Because calcium increases acid secretion. So then aluminium salts again, various forms are available like aluminium carbonate, hydroxide, phosphate, etc. And the aluminium, they have some constipatory effect also. So it's used with magnesium which causes diarrhea. So the combination of these two, magnesium and aluminium or calcium, they counteract the side effects. Again, aluminium hydroxide is absorbed in only small amounts and eliminated via renal routes. That's why it's avoided in patients with renal problems, particularly they can cause neurotoxicity. Magnesium salts again, carbonate, hydroxide, tricyclic, etc. And they have a laxative effect also. So Maxef, as we all know, it causes, it's very commonly used to treat constipation. And it's usually used with other drugs like calcium and aluminium to counteract this effect also. And again, it's also dangerous and used in patients with renal failure, where there is a risk of hypermagnesia, and because magnesium is excreted via the kidneys. So along with the antacids, many preparations, they have a combination with antiflagellant agents. What are antiflagellants? They alter the elasticity of the mucus-coated bubbles and causing them to break. The small bubbles, they break down and they are erected out. They relieve the painful symptoms like abdomen distension and bloating. They are very used often, but there are very limited data to support their effectiveness. What is commonly used in many antacid preparations are dimethicone, which was initially used. Nowadays, cimethicone is added, which is a silicated form of the dimethicone. Actually, they don't have much side effects. Actually, they are very used in pregnancy also. So then, along with antacids, with alginates again, this combination also, what is alginate? This is obtained from seaweed, the kadalpasinoga in Tamil, actually. These are natural polysaccharide polymers isolated from the brown seaweed. Upon contact with gastric acid, it precipitates into a low-density viscous gel. So once you take, it forms a thick viscous gel. Okay? this surface, it acts as a raft or a barrier. So over the food and acidity, it forms a raft, and then the symptoms are relieved immediately. So the barrier helps prevent stomach acid from moving up into the esophagus. So the symptomatic relief is excellent with this preparation. So by the way, what is acid neutralizing capacity? It is a way to express the ability of an antacid. Sorry. Alright. Again, see, it is a way to express the ability of an antacid to neutralize the acid by determining the antacid neutralizing capacity. It is expressed as milli equivalents of acid that is neutralized, and it measures the ability of the antacid to neutralize the acids to a pH to less than 4. Normally about 1 to 1.5 is there, so much to a pH 3.5 to 4 is enough. So as per the FDA requirements, an antacid must have a neutralizing capacity of greater than 5 milli equivalent per dose. So these are the various preparations available, like calcium carbonate, which is potent and rapidly acting. The disorder, as I said, is a hypercalcemia, and so-called the milk alkali syndrome. So as you all know, acid plus base react to form salt and water. So all this calcium, magnesium, aluminium, everything, they get converted into chloride form in the stomach. So the calcium gets converted into calcium chloride in the stomach, which leads to hypercalcemia. And in the long run, it leads to renal stone disease as well as pointed to renal failure. So this is otherwise called as a milk alkali syndrome. This happens only in the long term usages. Magnesium trisilicate, the calcium carbonate is very effective. The ALC is about 58. So magnesium trisilicate, again, the problem is with renal disorders. Magnesium carbonate, magnesium hydroxide, this is available, so called the milk of magnesia available. This magnesium and aluminium hydride form occurs mixed together. Again, when symptomatic, it's very useful. Then nowadays we have carbon, it is not available in our place actually. Calcium along with aluminium hydride, again, this is very useful, but it's not available in our place right now. Aluminium hydroxide, so-called the aludrox, time tested actually. Then soda bicarb, very few indications for it. So what are the various uses for antacids? Commonly used for abdominal set dyspepsia, peptic ulcers. Peptic ulcer disease, nowadays we don't use it at all. So in those days, it was the only drug available, but still they say the dose what we use, 40 times the dose if you use, it's equivalent to histone receptor blockers. But the side effects are very high and better drugs are available nowadays. So now commonly used only for dyspepsia, stress gastritis, and GRD again, symptomatic relief. Again for constipation. Bile acid diarrhea, because aluminium binds bile acids. And very rare, this is only theoretical. Chronic renal failure, you can use because aluminium binds dietary phosphates. For commercial preparation, they have salts, antiflagellants, alginates, as well as anesthetic agents. But there is no scientific basis for using that oxytocin. Most of the preparations, they mention that, but in our gastro, we don't use it at all. Even in our books, they don't recommend that oxytocin. But many commercially available antacid preparations, they have that also. So magnesium, again, it causes osmotic diarrhea, aluminium constipation. So these, the combined effect, the patient feels better symptomatically. So available various forms, capsule, tablet, powder, chewable tablet, suspension, etc. And again, when antacids are taken on an empty stomach, they provide reduction for 20 to 40 minutes only because the antacid is rapidly emptied into the duodenum. Okay, so we want really local action. So better when it's taken after a meal, approximately 1 to 2 hours also, we reduce acid for at least 3 hours as food slows emptying from the stomach. So ideally it's taken 2 to 3 after food as well as at the time of hour of sleep. So oral suspension, again, they're more rapidly and effectively solubilized than powders or tablets. Again, tablets when you take, it has to be chewed thoroughly before swallowing. Okay, so it's used in peptic ulcer again, it's used only as an adjunctive therapy along with PPI or histone receptor blockers. And if the antacids are used for treatment of peptic ulcer, usually high dose regimens for ulcer healing, which employs 80 to 160 milliequivalent acid neutralizing capacity, which is given 1 to 3 hours after meals as well as at bedtime. So many people they say, so after you consume food, so on top of the food there will be some acid, so called acid pockets or acid islands. So that can be taken care of by the antacids. So antacids per se, even in peptic ulcer diseases, you can give, so for this particular reason. And actually for patients with taking non-steroidal antibiotics, usually it's not recommended because it gives a false sense of security because it will hide the basic symptoms. So ideally we don't prescribe antacids for patients who are taking non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. things are actually, what are the major adverse effects? Aluminium antacids, hypophosphatemia with prolonged administration. Calcium again, acid reflux phenomenon, as well as the milk alkali syndrome. Magnesium again, hypermagnesemia, particularly in renal problem. Soda bicarb, metabolic alkalosis, the dreaded combination. So last slide. So again, antacids, they have more of drug interactions also, but more important is diazepam. They increase the diazepam absorption with aluminium antacids. Can occur. So, increased diazepam as well as in pseudoephedrine, there is an increased absorption along with aluminium hydroxide. But most of the drug, there is this, most of the with other drugs, there is only decreased absorption, but more is important is digoxin. And particularly in pregnant ladies taking iron, it decreases absorption of iron solids. And again, antibody tetracycline also, it decreases the tetracycline absorption. So, mainly the use of antacids, like anti acids, is mainly for symptomatic relief in patients with dyspepsia, where it gives an instant relief. Thank you.
Any questions?
So, it's one of the
very common thing in clinical practice. Generally, person or a middle-aged person comes with anti-religious pain discomfort, and we tend to give antacid and anti-spasmodic thinking for the dyspepsia. Then it turns on to myocardial event. Same way, some people are afraid and go into myocardial event investigations and finally tend to be gastrointestinal. Now, we like to add two or three points which will be in favor of the asymptomatic disease besides the myocardial event.
Actually, it's not that easy to differentiate between these two type of pains actually, because many of the patients, again, we have seen, I worked in ICC also before for 4 years actually. So many people, we think myocardial infarction, they turn out to be GRD essentially. And many people, we think GRD, ask them to come tomorrow, they really get an infarct, sometimes ECG may be normal and they So whenever there is an so-called alarm symptoms, we say there is a severe abdominal pain, or history of upper GI bleeding, or there is a weight loss, we give more importance and we plan for endoscopy and we proceed further. So otherwise, when there is any really suspicion, we ask the patient to go for treadmill or proceed further. So for us, these three things, alarm symptoms in GI, with the severe pain in abdomen, vomiting bread or melina, weight loss or jaundice, these three are the alarm symptoms. When there is, when these things are there, we give significant importance and we proceed further. Thank you.
And I request Professor Evans to come forward and have a certificate of appreciation. Dr. Arvind.